Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. We have a lot of information to share with you today, and we're going to also have a guest. I'm going to give extra time to our guest because the theme is very important. I'll look at the transition and fundamental change in the power in Saudi Arabia and the current U.S.-Saudi relationship. My guest will be Ali Al-Aman. And he is a Saudi scholar and a researcher. He's an expert in Saudi Arabia's political affairs, including the history of the Saudi royal family and Islamic movements and Wahhabism and the Saudi-American foreign relations and the repressive social and political and personal conditions in the kingdom. He is founder and current director at the Institute for Gulf Affairs in Washington, D.C., and Ali has been an invited speaker at Princeton University, Amnesty International, the Hudson Institute, and other places. And he is also, the Institute's website is gulfinstitute.org. He will be with us for an extended period of time today. We also have some audio clips that I'll be playing for you, and hopefully you'll find them of interest. I wanted to also talk about the school lunch program and how bad it is. And it could be so much better. So we're going to focus on that. We're also going to focus upon how we as human beings could make the world different if we broke our addiction to plastic. And what would the world have been like had we not had plastic? So we're going to talk about that, and then we're also going to look at, let's see what else we have here. Well, the styrofoam. I found something interesting. I don't know how old he is, I'm 11, 12 years old. This young kid invented a way to recycle styrofoam, which normally takes 500 years to decompose. And also I found on the Young Turks, this general, Terence O'Shaughnessy, revealed the full deployment details of the Pentagon's unprecedented deployment to aid Customs and Border Patrol at the border. Now, normally, this wouldn't be allowed. But because of what Obama did with the National Defense Authorization Act, it allowed it. So you heard about some troops being down there. This is far more than the troops. You'll hear about all that. So we have a lot to share today, and we always start with the latest on health and healing. And today, from Virginia Commonwealth University, is a study about vitamin D. And it shows that vitamin D levels in your blood are directly linked to cardiorespiratory fitness. And this was published in the European Journal of Preventive Cardiology. And, quote, our study shows that higher levels of vitamin D are associated with better exercise capacity. We also know from previous research that vitamin D has a positive effect on the heart and bones. Make sure your vitamin D levels are normal to high. You can do this with diet supplements and a sensible amount of sun exposure, end quote. I agree. When you're out in the sun, that's great. Take the supplement. That ensures it. Also, a lot of people have pain. I'm asked all the time, how do you overcome diabetic neuropathy pain, one of the worst? And this is the NISAM Institute of Medical Science. And this was published in the journal Ayurvedic and Integrative Medicine. It talks about the powerful pain-relieving properties of ashwagandha, A-S-H-W-A-G-A-N-D-H-A, ashwagandha. That's an herb. So people experiencing knee joint pain and discomfort, particularly those with knee osteoarthritis, can find relief in an Ayurvedic medicine called ashwagandha. This was a study that was done and the results published. But I found it's better than just for joint pain. It also, ashwagandha works for other pain in the body as well. From the University of Eastern Finland comes a study published in the British Journal of Nutrition about fermented dairy foods like yogurts and kefirs that can protect against a heart attack. So those who ate plenty of fermented dairy products had a smaller risk of coronary heart disease than those who ate less. And that's important. This was done at the University of Eastern Finland. So if you're concerned about your heart, and if you're not allergic to dairy, then that would be fine. From McGill University, that's in Montreal, Canada, cannabis extract relieves chronic pain minus the high. So researchers have pinpointed how cannabinoids, or the CBDs, can relieve pain safely without any side effects. And especially in wake of cannabis legalization in Canada, a team of scientists has delivered encouraging news for chronic pain sufferers by pinpointing the effective dose of marijuana plant extract, and it's a cannabinoid, for safe pain relief without typical high or euphoria that THC produces. The findings were published in the peer-reviewed journal Pain. So, again, this is not smoking marijuana. This is taking the oil, the CBD, and using it versus when you smoke it, you end up with the side effects from THC, which is not healthy. Also, getting into the flow. Sexual pleasure is a kind of trance. This is Northwestern University. They're saying that orgasm is all about rhythmic timing. Now, I haven't heard this before, and I've written and I've done a documentary called Sexual Healing. But they're saying that many people have speculated on the evolutionary functions of the human orgasm, but the underlying mechanisms have remained mysterious. So in this new paper, researchers seek to shed light on how orgasms works in your brain. And Professor Adam Saffron, a neuroscientist, in psychology in the brain Department of Brain Behavior Cognition at Weinberg College of Science, reviewed all the studies in the scientific literature on this and came up with a model in which rhythmic sexual activity is influencing brain rhythms. And he studied how the rhythmic stimulation can enhance neural oscillations at corresponding frequencies. Something like pushing a swing with someone on it. And through this process called neural entrainment, if sexual stimulation is intense enough and goes on long enough, synchronized activity could spread throughout the brain. And this synchronicity can produce such intensity and focused that sexual activity outcompetes usual self-awareness for access to consciousness. So producing a state of sensory absorption and trance. And this is crucial for allowing for a sufficient intensity of experience to trigger the mechanisms of climax. Sounds a little complicated, but it comes down to this. Here's what they say, quote, synchronization is important for signaling propagation in the brain because neurons are more likely to fire if they are stimulated multiple times within a narrow window of time. Otherwise, the signals decay as part of a general resetting mechanism rather than some together. This then caused me to hypothesize that rhythmic entrainment is the primary mechanism by which orgasmic thresholds are surpassed, end quote. Okay, that's what they're saying. They could be right or wrong. It's just a hypothesis. I'll tell you from a different perspective. I believe that the orgasm is not what is most important. Instead, I believe that what is important is for people to share a common vision. because generally you have two different visions, two different modes of excitement, arousatory stimulation. Women and men do not always share what they're thinking, their fantasies, their projections, because if your behavior is, let's say, a normal behavior when you're not having sex, are you willing to surrender for that moment to be vulnerable, to show that you also have this pleasure principle you'd like to engage in with this person that you're trusting, and you want to share that experience? And hence, people that you would never think would be yelling and screaming and saying all kinds of sexual talk would do so in that environment. So a lot of people hold their thoughts, hold their fantasies, don't share it, and as a result, they constrict. When you constrict energy, it's not free to flow. The energy doesn't flow, the thoughts don't flow. So you're going through an act, but it's like kissing a mannequin. You know, there's not going to be any exchange. Whereas when two people share something they both enjoy in common, their pleasure principles are being met. You share a common image, you share a common fantasy, a common fetish, and now you're in a synchronization. Your energies are harmonizing. And if you take your time and you're open and vulnerable, the energy expands, it goes further. And at a certain point, you're in perfect rhythm. And your breath, your bodies, your fantasies, your feelings, and that's that openness. That's what happens when we free ourselves enough to be authentic. If you have any fear, if you have any hesitation, you constrict. When you constrict, you're not in harmony. You can go through an act, but you're not going to have the same results. And whether or not an orgasm is a part of that or not is really of no relevance. We put too much emphasis on racing towards an orgasm as if that's the object. It's not. The wonder of sharing a moment in time with someone that we will never be able to share that same moment again. We'll share other moments, but not that one. And so you're just having the time of your life in that moment. You have trust, you have consciousness, you have awareness, and you have the capacity to share the pleasures with the person that you're with. That's how I would describe it. From Washington University School of Medicine, a new article about broccoli and cucumbers and avocados, all of which could be had in the same salad, by the way. And much of human health hinges on how well the body manufactures and uses energy. I talk about energy all the time. And for reasons that are not always clear, cells' ability to produce energy declines with age. I believe it's because we overtax with cortisol, our stress hormone, the mitochondria, which is the energy-producing part of our cells. And as a result, the more mitochondria that we deplete or destroy, the less energy we have. So as the older we get, the more negative experiences we've encountered, the more stress we have encountered, the less energy we have. That's why if you grow older with happiness and joy, you're going to have more energy. So anyhow, they're saying that they have now found an enzyme. It's found in broccoli and cucumbers and avocados. And it slows the chronic conditions of aging. This is really neat, and this is brand new. So what it is called NMM. N for Nancy, M for Mary, N for Nancy. NMN. And it can compensate for this loss of energy production, reducing typical signals of aging, such as gradual weight gain, loss of insulin sensitivity, and declines in physical activity. This was published in the heavyweight journal Cell Metabolism. And so the chemical is a nicotinamide, mononucleotide, and it's involved in producing another compound that's crucial for energy metabolism. So let us start looking around, because I'm quite sure that sooner rather than later, we will start seeing this NMN, which is a natural product, somewhere on our shelves of the health food stores. By the way, right now, NAD synthesis is the hottest thing out there. So hot that you can't even get more than, I think, 4 bottles at a time. And it's one of the best ways of regulating fat in the body also. Could fasting impact diabetes? This is prevent disease, and the answer is yes. And this is a big deal. Why? Because weight gain can be driven not only by what we eat, but also by our tendency to eat all day long. So in the past few years, intermittent fasting has emerged as a popular trend in weight loss, and a growing number of physicians also are prescribing fasting to people with type 2 diabetes. Now, what do I mean by intermittent fasting? I mean allowing your body to use fat as its primary source of energy instead of sugar, and there are multiple benefits to this. It's been proven empirically, and I've done it clinically, but researchers sought to explore exactly what type of diet and exercise works best to prevent diabetes affecting almost 500 million people worldwide and over 100 million in the United States with pre-diabetes and diabetes. There's evidence that suggests that fasting every other day for part of the day can help our health with caloric restriction, and that's important. And type 2 diabetes, of course, is triggered in part by unhealthy eating, which renders the body resistant to insulin. That's a hormone produced by the pancreas. And without insulin, sugar from food can't enter our cells, leaving the blood with an excess amount of it. And at first, the pancreas compensates by making more insulin, but eventually the demand wears out and the digestive organ is damaged. And diabetics then become dependent on insulin injections to control their blood sugar. So fasting undoes that cycle. Not eating reduces your blood sugar for periods of time. And if you do it on a daily basis, it will make a huge difference. And there are several studies that support intermittent fasting, including one published recently in Cell Metabolism, found that eating only between 8 a.m. and 2 p.m. instead of the more common 8 a.m. to 8 p.m., which is 12 hours, help people with early signs of diabetes respond better to their body's natural insulin. So here's the takeaway message, and I'll tell you how I do it. I only eat one meal a day, but I have what would be a meal, but it's liquid, in the morning where I have, you name it, I have every kind of plant protein and vegetable powders and fresh fruits like pomegranate and probiotics, nut butters, seed butters, all in one, what my friends call Gary's mud, because it looks like a bowl of mud. And I take about a small bowl of that each day, liquefy it, and then I eat it. That supplies me for at least 5 hours to 6 hours with everything my body needs to repair, to restore, to rejuvenate. Then in the early afternoon, I have my one primary meal. And then in the early evening, I'll have something simple, what I call grazing food. You know, I might have an avocado cut up some avocado with sweet onion and some olives and put a marinade on that, lemon, maybe a lemon tangerine juice, and have that as a snack. Each day it changes. But that's it. I don't need anything the rest of the night. Now, that's all done by 5 o'clock. So from 5 in the evening till probably around 9 the next day, I'm not eating. So if I'm eating from 9 to 5, then I shorten the period of time that my body's metabolism is being affected. So I keep it a lean weight, low percentage body fat, enormous amount of energy, and that's something I could recommend other people do. So if you're eating all day long and into the night, that's where we have our obesity and diabetes problems. 1 month of abstinence from cannabis, marijuana, the smoking of marijuana, improves your memory, especially in young adults. This is from Massachusetts General Hospital, published in the Journal of Clinical Psychiatry. And why is this a problem? Now, here's where it gets a little complicated, so I need you to listen carefully to what I'm saying. Otherwise, people will filter what I say and hear what they need to say. I can break it into these sections. A, all drugs should be legalized with appropriate treatment centers free to the public in every community to detoxify people from the unwanted effects, whether it's methamphetamine or marijuana. There's a myth that smoking marijuana is great for you and helps alleviate cancers and everything and pain. That's a myth. In point of fact, marijuana smoke is more carcinogenic than cigarette smoke, many times more. It also has multiple negative impact. It's happened to my own personal friends. I've seen two lives completely destroyed because it created paranoid delusion, it created psychosis, and people were heavy users. And it wasn't transient. It was permanent. One of my buddies from my whole adult life ended up living up in the mountains of, well, they're not really mountains, but the hills of Hawaii. He couldn't function around people. He was so delusional. And his son, really nice guy, tried everything, but he wouldn't stop the smoking. So on the one hand, smoking marijuana is dangerous. It's carcinogenic. It affects your lungs, affects your brain. It can really damage your brain. Now, here's where we go to the good part. The oils in the marijuana plant can be extracted and synthesized into a non-addictive, non-hallucinogenic, non-euphoric, highly beneficial medicinal healing. It can help the oil, can help the cannabinoids, can help with seizures, autism, brain cancer, lung cancer, and other blood conditions. In fact, there's 22,000 studies in the peer-reviewed literature, in the library of medicine, just on marijuana, and on cannabis oils and what it does. In fact, in Israel, the one research center there has probably done more extensive research on the healing benefits of cannabinoids than any other place on the planet. So it heals. It's wonderful. It's beneficial. We should be giving it to vaccine-injured children. And yet, unlike other more civilized countries, it's all for profits from the alcohol industry and the pharmaceutical industry. It's been made illegal, and it's been under the Clintons, people put in prison for long times. So you've got a positive and negative. It's a double-edged sword, depending upon how it is used. So I wanted to share that with you. And this study is just one of many that backs this up. And finally, suicide is more prevalent than homicide in the United States. From University of Washington, in the United States, suicide is twice as common as homicide. And more often than not, involves firearms. But public perception is just the opposite. News reports and movies and television contributes to the perception of a high risk of firearm homicides. And yet it's suicide by a person's own hand. And this study was done at the University of Washington, Northwestern University, and Harvard University. And this was published in the Annals of Internal Medicine. And because we are so confused by all this, starting next week, I'm going to focus my energies, since I've completed two new articles this week on the environment, on vets killing themselves, and showing the underlying real causes of the medications they're on, and actually proving it. I'll present it as a one-hour radio special, but also do it as an article So we'll show you what's behind all the suicide in teenagers, in women between the ages 25 and 45, in all these vets, 22 a day. So that'll be a project I'm going to put my attention to. We are 25 minutes into our program. That's the latest on health and healing. We'll be back in a moment. Please stay with us.
If you want something to play with, go and find yourself a toy. Baby, my time is too expensive, and I'm not a little boy.
Just want to thank everyone for taking your time to listen in. Hope you listened to last night's progressive commentary. It was really in-depth and interesting, and a topic that you never hear discussed, certainly not from a leading scientist on the subject, probably the most knowledgeable person on the planet on the science of precognition, telepathy, and other subjects of psi research. If you didn't listen in last night, by all means, go to the website, the archives, and download last night's show. It is a mind twist. Got a lot of positive reviews on it. Call this number for our archives, 701-719-9976, 701-719-9976, and download last night's show. Now we're going to go to three short audio clips back to back to back, and then to our guest. This one's about the shocking truth of our school lunch program. That'll be followed by this young kid's inventing a brilliant way to recycle styrofoam. And the last will be the Young Turks talking about how this general is justifying putting all this hardware and equipment and all that's going on, not just some troops down at the border, but wait to hear what he has to say. So those will be our clips in that order.
Our kids, this garbage food. Foods that slow our thinking down, make us tired, sluggish, anxious, unclear. And on top of all that, doesn't even taste good. Welcome to school lunch, where they tell you that milk does the body good and builds nice strong bones, while science tells us that it actually does the opposite. Not only is it low in calcium compared to other foods, studies show that it's actually a risk factor for developing prostate cancer. Studies are also showing a higher risk of bone fracture with the more milk you drink. Research done in Sweden studied over 100,000 men and women over a 20 plus year period. The results showed that milk drinking women have higher rates of death, heart disease, and cancer. And three glasses of milk a day is associated with twice the risk of death. Welcome to school lunch, where the closest thing you get to a vegetable is pizza because of the tomato paste. Look, when we talk about food and its effect on a student's success, there is no debate. We have clear scientific evidence to show that food affects cognitive function. In 2008, the Journal of School Health discovered that fifth graders eating fast food scored worse on standardized literary assessments. A follow-up study of fifth graders published in the Journal of Educational Research in 2012 linked eating fast food to declining math and reading scores. Another study showed that schools that contract with healthy lunch vendors actually score higher on state achievement tests. So once again, it is not debatable when I say that food affects a student's success. And so I want to believe that this is just an oversight of the people who are in charge. But the fact that so many school menus are filled with garbage makes me think that there might be a conspiracy to keep kids from reaching their potential by making them incapable of free thought, keeping them tired, lazy, and ultimately sabotaging their future. It is truly in everybody's best interest to have healthier students, because healthier students equals better test scores. Better test scores equals more funding for the school. It is a virtuous cycle. But even if food didn't lead to better test scores, which it does, isn't it worth teaching children good habits and good food choices so that when they become adults, they know how to be healthy and don't have to live a life suffering with obesity, cancer, diabetes, strokes, these preventable diseases that are wreaking havoc on our world today? What better opportunity than to teach young people while they're young proper nutritional habits? And look, eating healthy doesn't mean students have to eat dry, tasteless vegetables. Contrary to popular belief, healthy does not mean disgusting. We can make food healthy and taste good, and we can make food fun. Brian Wasnick of Cornell University conducted a study that showed that when you give cool names to things like vegetables, students are more likely to eat them. Names like X-ray vision carrots or power peas. Similar results have been found in adults too. A restaurant study showed that when the seafood fillet was turned into succulent Italian seafood fillet, sales went up 28%. And taste rating went up by 12%. So look, do we want higher test scores? Do we want healthy children? Do we want a world full of healthy, happy adults? If you answer yes to any of these, then we need to start rethinking school lunch.
Get a new flat screen TV? You end up with a block of styrofoam bigger than the TV itself. Drink a cup of coffee? Well, those styrofoam coffee cups are sure gonna add up. And where do all these items go after their one-time use? Many plastics. Simply put, recycled polystyrene is too expensive and potentially contaminated, so there is very little market demand for styrofoam that has to be recycled. My team hypothesized that we could use the carbon that is already in styrofoam to create activated carbon, which is used in almost every water filter today. And activated carbon works by using very small micropores to filter out contaminants from water or even air. So we kept trying and failing and trying and failing. We were so ready to give up. But then it happened. With the right temperatures, times, and chemicals, we finally got that successful test result showing us that we had created activated carbon from styrofoam waste. We took a problem that many people said was impossible, and we made it possible. Not only were we able to create activated carbon for purifying water, but we were also able to reduce styrofoam waste, solving two global problems with just one solution.
Our mission of Homeland Defense is inextricably linked to Department of Homeland Security's mission of Homeland Security. Operation Faithful Patriot, as we've named the military operation supporting CBP in hardening the Southwest border, is the latest example of this critical partnership. In a macro sense, our concept of operations is to flow in our military assets with a priority to build up southern Texas, and then Arizona, and then California. We'll reinforce along priority points of entry so as to enhance CBP's ability to harden and secure the border. The specific request for assistance is for the active duty military to enhance the capacity and capabilities of CBP by providing robust military capabilities. Our first level of effort with CBP will be to harden the points of entry and address key gaps in areas around the points of entry. And here's a list of just some of the capability that we're bringing. First, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, they bring amazing expertise earned through years of experience under challenging conditions, including the current work of building the border wall. We're also bringing three highly experienced and capable combat engineering battalions with expertise in building temporary vehicle barriers, fencing, and are bringing them in with heavy equipment, which as we speak right now is line hauling towards Texas. We're bringing military planning teams that are already actively engaged with their CBP counterparts. We've integrated command and control capabilities. We're working with our aviation engineering, medical, and logistic resources to bring them to bear. We're bringing three medium-lift helicopter companies in. These are aircraft equipped with the latest technology. They're enhanced with optics. They have NVGs. They have sensors that will allow them to operate at night and be able to provide assistance to bring our CBP personnel exactly where they need to be, regardless of the conditions. We'll be able to spot identify groups and rapidly deploy CBP personnel where they're needed. The helicopters will ensure the CBP agents can arrive in the most austere locations. They can fast rope down if they need to. They can conduct and work their law enforcement activities. These aircraft will also ensure those agents needing medical assistance will be able to get that assistance when required. In addition, we're bringing military police units. We're bringing strategic airlift to bear. As we sit right now, we have three C-130s and a C-17 that is ready to deploy CBP personnel wherever they need to be at any time. We have deployable medical units. We have the logistical support. We have command posts. We're bringing again command posts so we can combine with CBP, and we have combined command posts where our operational commanders will be working side by side to integrate our efforts. And make no mistakes, as we sit right here today, we have about 800 soldiers that are on their way to Texas right now. They're coming from Fort Campbell. They're coming from Fort Knox. They're moving closer to the border. They're going to continue their training, and they're ready to deploy to be actually employed on the border. We're deploying aviation assets that quickly transport our CBP personnel. But it isn't just the men and equipment and the soldiers that we're bringing. We've already brought critical material, and it's already in place. We have enough concertina wire to cover up to 22 miles already deployed, already to the border. We have additional concertina wire that we can string with over 150 miles available. Additionally, working at where the reinforcers are needed so we can get it exactly where CBP wants us to put it. By the end of this week, we will deploy over 5,200 soldiers to the southwest border. That is just the start of this operation. We'll continue to adjust the numbers and inform you of those, but please know that's in addition to the 2,092 that are already employed from our National Guard Operation Guardian support that's been so effective.
Okay, you were just hearing a general talk about his point of view. That's General Terrence O'Shaughnessy. And he couldn't do this, understand this, unless Obama signed the National Defense Authorization Act, which, by the way, if you don't know the act, here's why Chris Hedges was so angered by it. He went down to the White House, protested, and was arrested. It allows the President of the United States to arrest any human being anywhere without habeas corpus, no right to defend yourself. You're not given the information against you. You can be held indefinitely. You can be killed without recourse to those who kill you. You can be tortured. That's Obama. That's the dark side of his bright personality, that charm, that charm offensive that he won so many voters over. Same way with Bill Clinton. They have a charming side and they have a very negative side. And the laws that he passed that impact us in a negative way, this is the consequence of one. We no longer can say that we have a law in effect, which we did have, that prevented American soldiers from being deployed against Americans or on our soil. So this is serious. Now, you know what he didn't say? He didn't say that we should be understanding why people are coming. Set aside that there will always be those who exploit a situation to their advantage. Always. But they are not the vast majority. The vast majority are coming because they're poor farmers, and drought has adversely affected them year after year. And they are low-carbon footprint citizens. They're not flying in private jets. They're not, you know, heating gigantic, you know, Manhattan apartments. They're not buying all kinds of consumer goods, all of which increase global warming. These are very poor people. They live close to the earth. They don't want to leave their heritage and a home. They have no choice but to starve otherwise. So they're trying to find a way of surviving. Shouldn't we be understanding that and open to inviting him in an expeditious way to come to our country? There's room for them. We have not taken responsibility at all, either the Democrats or Republicans, because they're both equally guilty, of sponsoring regime change terrorist groups, training them at the School of the Americas, and with the CIA helping them to exploit and grow the organized narco-terrorist groups. And we did it with all of them. We didn't do that, and we should have. We should have taken responsibility. We created the demand for the drugs, and then we turned around and we exploited the situation. And the CIA gave arms to the Contras, and they gave us cocaine. So that created an unstable economy. And now 200,000 people have died or disappeared in Mexico alone. And that's the drugs and the gangs and the cartels. And we actually supply intelligence and arms to the cartels. So what happens when you're just a regular family and your daughter is told that she's going to have to go to the United States to work for 5 years in a brothel, otherwise her parents will be shot. And she's poor, and the parents have no choice. The police can be bought, and are, in all these Central and South American countries. Are we speaking to them? Do we understand their pain? Nope. So you see, it's one thing to say we're armed. We have the Corps of Engineers. We have drones. We have weaponized drones. We can stretch wires for 150 miles in one place and 22 in another place. We have all this mechanization of war at our fingertips. Not one word about what we're doing to actually be open to help people for the crisis that we help create. Now, yes, you can bring them through so we know who they are, and we can see that they deserve to be here, and those that don't, they'll try to cross illegally. Those people should be arrested. The people who need to be here should be brought in and given, since they have nothing, they've frequently given everything they have to be here, we should help support them. Why don't we take our core engineers and build a gigantic transient complex there on our side of the border where there can be proper medical help, psychological help, schooling, language training, so they can learn English, so they can speak in places and get work they otherwise couldn't, where they could have crafts and skills, where they can have job placements. We should be doing things so that once again we're able to facilitate a multicultural environment in a positive way instead of what we're doing. It's all wrong what we're doing. Just my thoughts. Now we're going to go over and say hello to my guest who's standing by. I gave you his biographical information earlier. And Ali Al-Ahmad, and he's in Washington, D.C. Nice to have you with us today.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure.
There are several important issues on the table to discuss with respect to the transition of power that has taken place in Saudi Arabia since Prince Mohammed bin Salman has taken the reins of the kingdom's future from his father, still alive. And I'd like you to speak, please, about Yemen and the Saudi royal family's relationship with the United States on international affairs. I'd like for you to speak about the fact that only in the last 10 days has the New York Times and the Washington Post actually focused some attention on Yemen as if somehow they've just discovered it, that there's a war in Yemen and people are starving to death, and it's the greatest humanitarian crisis in the world. 29 million Yemenis are at risk, and today I posted two of the most horrifying photographs of two men. They're just bones. They're alive. They have that glassy-eyed look, and they're going to die because there's a blockade, and this, I don't have a word of contempt to describe my feelings towards this, the ruler of Saudi Arabia, which is an absolute ruler. There's a theocracy that's powerful, but no one has more power than he does. And I'd like for you to talk about what it means when you have a person who's so ambitious, so ruthless, that he will do anything he wants, and seemingly No country is willing to challenge him. Most of all, the United States. When he came here, everyone went out to greet him and praise him. Public relations firms, everyone was thinking how great, because he came to spend money. And so I know you have a deep knowledge about the history of the Saudi family, and your family has experienced firsthand what the regime's capable of in silencing voices speaking out about social and political change and persecuting dissidents and persons opposing the royal family and the theocratic doctrine of Wahhabism that rules over the nation. So I'd like you to first speak about the changes that are underway since bin Salman came to power and after the recent assassination of journalist Khashoggi, which we just found out today, he was killed almost immediately, strangled to death, then beheaded. There was no real long interrogation, as we've been told, and there wasn't any fight, as we've been told, and it's all lies. And yet our president, everyone else, all the media, left and right, say the same thing. Well, yes, it was a bad thing, and let's wag our finger at him and say, you don't ever do that again, and we're not going to allow any of those 15 assassins back into our country. But otherwise, this business is usual. And I feel that that is just deplorable what they're doing. Your thoughts, the forum is yours.
Thank you so much for having me. It's my pleasure to be here. This is a very complex issue. You have a monarchy that is a product of a Western power. That was the UK who created this monarchy and similar monarchies in our region, in the Gulf, namely, basically in its own image. And what it couldn't do in the UK, it did it in our country. The UK started this sort of these rules and these standards that the monarch in Saudi Arabia, he's basically the god of the country. He has absolute, complete, unchallenged power to do anything. He's using an ideological, religious ideological belief to carry on this absolute rule. Wahhabism is really just a tool that has been used by the monarchy. I've written an article years ago in Politico magazine, and I explained it. You know, yes, you have the popular scapegoat, the Wahhabis. All so-called Saudi experts in the U.S. and the U.K. say, oh, the Wahhabis are the one who are holding the country back. The king is great. He's, you know, forward-thinking. And every Saudi leader is a reformer. This is not the first, MBS is not the first leader that the U.S. media and British media calls, or the Western governments calls, a reformer. That has been the case since the 1950s. And I have spoken to U.S. State Department years ago about this, and I said, you know, all your statements says the king or the prince, never the people. They started changing that. It was during the Obama administration. The problem we have in our country, that we have a population that are very much as like slaves. The Saudi monarchy looks at us as their possession. The country is their possession. And we are only servants who receive and they bestow upon us the right to inhabit the land and to live, and they gave us everything. And this is nothing, I'm exaggerating. We have this in recording, we heard it in meetings. We give you everything you have. We educated you, we built your homes, we bring you hospitals. We give you, and this is how you treat us. The monarchy thinks this is their country, this is their plantation. That's why they named the country after themselves. And they named us after themselves. You know, my grandfather or my great-grandfather was never called a Saudi. This is a new thing. That's hopefully my life goal, is to remove that. We have been, you know, the Arabian Peninsula have been in existence forever. The name Arab and Arabian Peninsula has been, you know, thousands of years. So I don't know why we have to change it for a ruling family or a clan. Having said that, this family has, you know, was really imposed upon us by the UK, who supported them with modern weaponry and even had English generals leading Saudi forces against our tribes. The formation of Saudi Arabia led to the killing of hundreds of thousands of people. It was basically cowboys and Indians. The cowboys here are the Saudis, because they had the British machine guns, and the Indians are our tribes who had nothing more than a musket and some swords to defend against the Saudi army, who was well-funded by the British, who wanted to cut up the Ottoman Empire at the time and divide the Arabs from the Turks. So because this is the base, we have the largest absolute monarchy in the world that controls two important key elements here. Is what I call is the heart of God, Mecca and Medina, the most important religious places in the world. And the gold is the largest oil reservoir known, at least easily be accessible, in the world. So with these two tools, the Saudi monarchy has devastated our people. If I talk about what they have done, they funded, they purchased the souls of many people in the West, presidents. You spoke earlier about Obama, and I agree with you completely on that, and I will talk about it in a second. So you have this absolute monarchy that does not allow any challenge. Our society has stagnated. Our life, our ambitions to dream of the smallest thing have been crushed by this monarchy, because they control every aspect of our lives. They lead the sport. They lead the economy. They lead all government posts, basically, with just marginal person here and there. But their representation in government is extremely high. Every governor is from the Al Saud. Every major minister is from the Al Saud. And this has been the case in the military, in business, you name it, even in music and media. So really, it is almost like an infestation. And this has created an environment of silence, of backwardness, and they infused religious extremism in it. And they took that to other countries, to Africa, to Asia, to the United States. And it was done. Just like the campaign in Afghanistan in the 80s, with the support and the coordination of the United States, either CIA or other agencies, you notice one thing here since 9/11. I'm just focusing on that period. We haven't heard a single American president or official. The same goes to Europeans. To call on the Saudis to allow women to drive, to have a national government, to have a constitution, to give the people the right to vote, or even to give the right people to rule, or to have a constitutional monarchy. It's very clear that the West wants these people to rule the same way, because it is beneficial for some Western official. There is something to talk about when you say that the Al Saud ruling family taking money from our mouths to give it to Jimmy Carter, to Obama, to Bush, to Clinton, to the Trump, to many other, to Tony Blair, to other many officials in America and in Europe. And of course, they don't give it because, you know, they like them. Because they want something in exchange. And they give it even to the UN. I have experienced that with the UN Human Rights Commission. They gave them $5 million and they shut up on Saudi Arabia. Although this Human Rights Committee or Commission has nothing but statements to do. So you see that they have bought hundreds of figures in the West that were elected by the American people, by the British people and other first world people. And what is the cost to us? It's complete devastation. And what is the cost to the world? increasing extremism, terrorism, and waste of billions, maybe trillions of dollars in economy that came from the selling of oil. It really was wasted on wars and bombs, just like you see it now in Yemen. We lost hundreds of billions of dollars starving and bombing our brothers, our ancestor land. Yemen is this ancestor of the land of the Arabs. We are bombing them. We are starving them, killing not 6,000 people or 10,000 people like the media is saying. At least 100,000 children alone were killed due to bombing, starvation, and disease caused by the Saudi that's supported by the United States from the Obama administration, not only the Trump, and continues to do so with British help as well, because we know British pilots are flying some of these missions. They are private pilots or former military pilots who are flying some of these missions that are killing children in Yemen every day.
One other question. I'm going to invite you back for a full hour because I want to go into greater depth on the history of the Saud family and what it means. So please keep it an hour aside for us so we can go into depth. But one final question.
Yes.
Now, we don't have a lot of time for it. That is this. This man has alienated his own family and relatives. Do you believe that there is a possibility for a coup against him, since he actually took 200 of his top citizens, including his own relatives, put him in the Ritz-Carlton, held them captive, many were tortured, until he confiscated hundreds of billions of dollars of their money to give them their freedom back? These people are not going to forget that. No one's going to forget that they're living under constant fear of this sociopath. Do you believe there's a potential for him to be overthrown?
It's very hard to overthrow Mohammed bin Salman. He is very powerful. He is the most powerful Saudi leader ever since the foundation of the Saudi state, because he has all the levers of power in his hand, the military, security, the political, and the economy in one hand. He's young and ambitious, and he's a violent person personally. So there is no other viable competitor. Yes, the family, they're angry at him. They don't like what he's doing, but they don't have the capacity. I think it's more to do with the capacity than with the way they feel about him. And unless there is an outside source or power to support these individual princes, then they will not have. When I say support, I mean military force, because the military force is in his pocket, and there could be a coup, but it has to be done, I think, by some individual or a military officer. We've seen that in Egypt, for example, in the 50s, and in Iraq as well, where the military took over the government through a coup. I don't see it right now, and I don't see any Western government supporting the overthrow of MBS. Like you said, the reaction has been very limited to statements. No real steps have been taken against MBS, and I don't see any steps being taken, real steps being taken against him. No alternative from the ruling family is available at this time, and I'm against it myself. We can rule ourselves. Thank you very much. We don't need a monarchy. This country, your country, America, had a monarchy, and you removed it to build a republic. I think our people deserve very similar outcome. The Americans of 1777, I don't think they are much more educated and knowledgeable and worldly than our people in 2018. So I think this is a very sacred right for our people, and we should all demand it. And I hope American officials will start saying it.
We look forward to a more extended conversation with you. Thank you very much, and I appreciate all your efforts to educate the world to the truth about Saudi Arabia. My guest from Washington, D.C., Ali Al-Ahmed. I'm Gary Null. We're out of time. Thank you all for listening. Have a nice day.